First Timothy chapter 6 tonight. First Timothy chapter 6. We live in a society where almost anyone today can claim victim status. It's actually a pretty rare thing in our society to come across people who are willing to say that they were raised in normal homes and have normal lives. Now, really, abnormal has become the new normal in our culture today. Now, for about 50 years, John Bradshaw was one of the leading fathers in the development of the modern psychology, addiction, and recovery movement. It's taken root very heavily in America and Western culture now. He was a prolific author and speaker around the world. He helped to shape much of the philosophy that's accepted in modern culture in those areas. He stated and taught in his various seminars and writings that 96% of us come from dysfunctional families. 96%. Americans particularly are flocking to all kinds of specialized self-help groups where they focus on how the traumas from their pasts have impaired their lives and left them victimized and helpless. And that's been a reality for the past several decades. It's not a new theme today, but it's something that's taken root and has shaped our culture to the way that people think now. Every sort of problem today, including criminal behavior, is excused because the perpetrator was a helpless victim of one thing or another from their past. All over the world, people are acquitted of everything from assault to murder because of some claimed victimization. Abuse as children, media influence, a temporary insanity, whatever that is, and a host of other reasons are given as to why a person should not be culpable for their actions. You know, there are over 200 different mental health disorders. I say disorders very loosely, but 200 diagnosed different mental health disorders that have been classified to help explain everything from moods to personalities to personal habits to energy levels or lack thereof, to social interaction, to post-traumatic stress. Everybody has post-traumatic stress today. Any difficult situation you go through may leave you with some kind of post-traumatic stress disorder diagnosis. If you want my Cliff Notes thoughts on mental illnesses, then feel free to see me after the service tonight. I'd be happy to share them with you. Well, unfortunately, the world isn't waking up to the stupidity of all this nonsense. It's actually getting worse and worse. A quote in the Los Angeles Times, funny enough, summed it up by declaring this: practically everyone is seen as a victim of something and therefore eligible for lifelong self-absorbed irresponsibility, which has trivialized real suffering and made psychic invalids of those who once had a bad day. Let's suppose, though, that you really are a victim. Maybe a parent or a spouse abuses you. Maybe you suffer racial discrimination, or on a lesser scale, maybe you're being treated unfairly at work. Maybe you're a victim of reverse discrimination, which is an ever-increasing trend in parts of our country today, where you're penalized because you're not classified as a minority. How should a Christian respond? This is really the question I want to drive at. How should a Christian respond when he or she is truly a victim of abuse or unfair treatment? I'm going to read this scripture. We'll read our text in just a minute here, but I'm trying to establish the framework for where we'll be going tonight in our study. And I want to clarify from the start that if you are now or ever in the future are being abused sexually or physically, you should immediately seek help so that your situation can be stopped. You still need to apply the things that I'm going to talk about today to your attitude, but I don't want you to mistakenly think that God wants you to endure that kind of abuse passively. There are certainly Fruitcake Church Ministries that may portray that as being a responsibility of people to endure. That's not what I'm saying tonight. A sexual offender or a violent person needs to be brought under the penalty of the law. If your attitude is right before God, I will say this, that there is definitely a place, a proper place for confrontation. In fact, we saw just a couple of weeks ago back in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 1 through 2, the proper procedure to be followed in confronting those who are in authority. I hope that you remember that. It was talking about how to confront pastors and elders and leaders in a church on a spiritual level who are in authority that are sinning or that are improper in the way that they're treating others. How should you deal with it if you are the victim? Very importantly, how should you folks, as church members here, how should you counsel a victimized person who comes to you for help? Because that realistically should be an increasing trend in your life if you're growing and becoming a more fruitful leader in Christ's service. How do you counsel them? How do you deal with it? Do we have a right to get angry at God for letting this happen? Some would claim that. Should we rail at God and let our rage out towards Him? Should we vent our rage towards the ones who abused us, either directly or indirectly by punching something and screaming? Should we stew over it for minutes, days, or years? Should we go to endless counseling sessions and seminars, remaining in a never-ending state of what's called recovery, and take on the perpetual identity of a victim or a survivor? Should we take a positive approach and build our self-esteem? Because what a downtrodden person really needs is self-respect. Should we tell ourselves over and over how wonderful we are? We deserve better than what's happened to us. Well, I mentioned all those things because the world offers all sorts of solutions for those who are victims. Some may sound reasonable. Some may even sound biblical. Some are championed by Christian counselors who quote verses to support their points, but they often mix biblical truth with subtle error that's very damaging. Now, friends, as always, we unequivocally state that we need to rely on God's word alone to learn how Christians who are mistreated should respond in their difficult situations. Today, we continue our study through 1 Timothy, and we're coming to chapter 6. We're just going to look at verses 1 and 2 tonight. Look at it with me. It says, "Let as many servants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, that the name of God and his doctrine be not blasphemed. And they that have believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brethren, but rather do them service because they are faithful and beloved, partakers of the benefit. These things exhort and teach." In the history of the sinful human race, slaves or servants, as they're called here, certainly have ranked among the most victimized of all people who have ever lived. The slaves were literally the property of their owners, who could use them and dispose of them as they saw fit. They were viewed and often treated like animals. This is really brought out to us in Paul's descriptive phrase, "under the yoke" here. He says, "Let as many servants as are under the yoke behave in this way." A yoke was a harness that oxen would be strapped into to plow a field. Slaves, like oxen, were under the yoke of their masters, used for the profit and the benefit of their owners with no personal rights at all. As we bring it into the historical context, estimates vary, but anywhere from one-third to over one-half of the Roman population in Paul's day were slaves, owned by other people. As the gospel message proliferated throughout the Mediterranean world and throughout the Roman Empire as a whole, many of those slaves were blessed to hear the message of reconciliation to God and hope of salvation in Jesus Christ. great numbers of them became Christians.
Vast numbers of them. How should these victimized people respond to the unjust situations that they found themselves in? Should they walk out in protest and strike to demand better work conditions? Should they revolt? There were a number of different slave revolts not too long after Paul wrote here. Should they express their rage at God or at society or at their owners? Should they focus on building their self-esteem? Well, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 1 and 2 gives us God's answer. Now, it's easy for us to just sit in comfort in our church and say, preach it to those slaves, Paul. They need to hear that. But Paul isn't just preaching to slaves in a faraway culture that no longer exists. His words apply to every single believer today who's a victim of abusive or unfair treatment. I go out on a limb and say that every one of us will at some time experience that ourselves, or will at least be in regular contact. If you're really serving God in the capacity that He intends, you'll be in regular contact with those who need to learn how to be a godly victim. I want to offer five very simple observations from this scripture tonight, and I pray that God will work through this scripture to bring a mature biblical perspective that you'll be able to apply as you walk through life and seek to minister for our Lord. So five principles. First of all, life isn't fair. You probably didn't want to hear that, did you? It's true. Most of the slaves in the Roman world of Paul's day were born that way. They were born into slavery. It wasn't that they committed a crime or they got into debt and ended up as a slave by consequence of their own foolishness. In some cases, they may have been captured, but mostly they were born into slavery. They didn't have any say in the matter. They had no say in their circumstances. That isn't fair, is it? It isn't fair that some people are born into plush, comfortable homes in the United States of America with plenty to eat, good medical care, plenty of money, and little to worry about except which name brand clothes to pick off of their closet rack to put on for the day, while other people are born in abject poverty, completely destitute, in countries like Somalia or Afghanistan or North Korea, where they can barely eke out just enough to pull a scant meal together to feed their starving families, assuming they don't get shot or step on a landmine before they have a chance to do it. It isn't fair. Some people have parents who love them and treat them with kindness and grace and godliness, while others are neglected and abused by their drug-addicted mother and her latest boyfriend. Let's face it. Life is grossly unfair, isn't it? The Bible never pretends any differently. Sin and its devastating effects make this evil world a tremendously unfair place. Let me point out that you don't solve that problem by eliminating God from consideration. The communists of the past generations thought that they could solve the problem of unfairness in the world by creating a classless society where everybody has equal status and opportunity. But it didn't work, and it still doesn't work, and it won't ever work, because they didn't deal with the intractable problem of the selfish, greedy human heart. So those in power abused their position for their own advancement. The haves still clung to what they had, while the have-nots greedily scrambled to take it away from them. By taking God out of the equation, you extinguish
the only true source of hope in a desperately unfair world. If there is no God, then this is just a dog-eat-dog world where the toughest, meanest dogs manage to survive a few years longer than the weaker dogs. If you happen to be born as a caged, diseased dog with a cruel master who beats you every day, it's a bummer for you. What's called determinism, the view that victims are completely at the mercy of fate or of outside forces, offers people absolutely no hope except to try to get into better circumstances for a short period of time. But even if you succeed, you'll die soon. So what have you really accomplished? Taking God out of the picture doesn't solve the problem of unfairness. Friends, the Bible is abundantly clear that if we got what was fair, we would all go straight to hell. We really can't say anything more than that. We've all rebelled against an eternal, holy God. Every one of us has cast off God's rightful rulership over us and has sought to live for self and for pleasure to the complete disregard of God and others. When we say this, please understand the application of what we're talking about here. When you or I get into a position that we see as unfair and we say, I don't deserve to be treated like I've been treated, we reveal our pride that lifts us up against a holy God as if we have some kind of claim against him, as if we have some kind of right against him. We all deserve God's wrath because of our rebellious, self-willed ways. Any earthly comforts that we enjoy are not because we deserve them or have a right to them. They only come from God's undeserved kindness that withholds the judgment that we really deserve. And so the first principle that we see as we can talk about how to properly, what we're calling how to be godly victims, is to realize that life is unfair. But secondly, life can have hope no matter how unfairly you've been treated or what type of unfair circumstance you find yourself in. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ brings hope to those who despair. The gospel can shine into the most rat-infested, foul prison cell and give instant hope of eternal life to a condemned prisoner. In Paul's day, the good news that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, even the chief of them, meant that these people that we're talking about tonight, who were treated as human work animals, could become gifted church members, all carrying equal status before God himself. They became heirs of the hope of eternal life with God himself in heaven. Slaves were coming to faith in Jesus Christ and were being saved. Political or economic solutions, if that's all that we focus on, offer only superficial hope to those who are oppressed, those who are unfairly treated. Paul could have used his efforts, and he could have used his writing and his persuasive capabilities to organize opposition to the institution of slavery. He could have called for a campaign for everybody to write their senator in Rome and protest the awful injustice of slavery. Maybe he could have even led an armed slave revolt. I'm sure there would have been plenty that would have followed him. It may have been a just cause, or he could have organized the slaves into trade unions to give them power to fight for better work conditions, to fight for higher wages or health care, paid vacations. But even if Paul had succeeded in that type of social change, what would he have really accomplished? Slaves would have lived better and easier lives, but they'd still die and go to hell if they didn't repent of their sins and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not suggesting that Christians shouldn't stand for righteousness in society in some cases, but we know all too well that comfortable people are the most difficult people to reach with the gospel message because they don't sense their need to be right with God before they die. And so in the end, it really doesn't accomplish much of anything except make our job even harder. And so what Paul did and what he engaged in was to preach the gospel message to slaves and to slave owners, because it alone is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, whether they're poor, whether they're rich, whether they're free, or whether they're slaves. The gospel alone can transform the self-centered, greedy human heart into a new creation that loves God and that loves others. The gospel alone can loosen our grasp and our love for the things of this world and put our focus on the life to come. The gospel alone meets the most basic need of every single human heart, and that's to be reconciled to a holy, eternal God. If you're a victim and you've been mistreated, God offers the same hope to you today. It's eternal. It's unchanging. It doesn't matter what generation or society you live in. The greatest hope that anybody can have is having their sins forgiven and knowing the living and true God through his son, Jesus Christ, who died to pay the penalty for all of your sins. But there's a third thing that you need to know. Life isn't fair. Life can have hope, no matter how unfairly you've been treated, if you'll believe in the gospel. But thirdly, becoming a Christian doesn't solve all your problems. These slaves that Paul was writing to were not instantly liberated from their slavery the minute that they believed in Jesus Christ. Many died as slaves. The next morning after salvation, every one of those slaves still had to get up and go out and meet the demands of their masters. They still had to do difficult, distasteful work. They still had to work long hours with little time off. Abusive masters weren't suddenly transformed into nice men and nice women just because their slaves were now Christians. In fact, we could say that in most cases, physical circumstances probably weren't much different for those slaves who became Christians. They probably never really changed all that much. In fact, the demands on them plausibly could have increased because of their new faith. Their owners probably taunted them with something like, if you're such a good Christian, why are you complaining about your workload? Kind of like Pharaoh did in the Old Testament, remember? We want to go worship the Lord and spend time with him. Well, you're idle. The fact that you can even come and ask for time to do this kind of worship to your God, you're idle. We're going to double your workload. As Christian slaves, these folks could no longer steal from their masters to make ends meet like they used to and like all the pagan slaves still did. And then Paul has the nerve to tell them that they not only needed to put up with all that, but they needed to honor these brutes and work even harder. No griping allowed. No complaining allowed. Life didn't get easier for these people that became Christians. It got harder as Christian slaves. At least the circumstances of life did. Now, here's a bit of truth and wisdom that we need to discern from this. We have to be careful that we don't misrepresent the gospel to people. I was recently researching a church website, and I saw what's commonly known as the four spiritual laws as their statement of faith. That literally was the only thing that was there as their statement of faith. The four spiritual laws are an easy believism type of manipulation. It's designed to try to get somebody to repeat a little prayer while completely circumventing the need for repentance and completely circumventing the need for genuine faith in Jesus Christ. It's a modern day gimmick that has filled so-called churches with lost people all over the world. The first of those four spiritual laws claims this: God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. Now, it is 100% true that God loves you. We can certainly say that. That's a biblical statement, but we better be very careful about misrepresenting the gospel to people as if it's a man-centered message that's going to give them a wonderful or abundant life. I understand that even those statements taken in a biblical context are also true. in a biblical sense or in a spiritual sense. But those statements about having a wonderful or abundant life are not packaged and sold by those peddlers as spiritual blessings. They're sold as physical blessings. It's really just another wrapping for the name it and claim it type of theology. The TV evangelists and other false prophets have been promoting for centuries, fleecing people out of their money and leaving those people who are fleeced feeling somehow satisfied that they've accomplished some religious duty. All the while, they've never addressed their real issue with God. When people are told that God has a wonderful plan for their lives, or that he offers them their abundant or best life now, that discounts the reality that God's wonderful plan may be that they suffer. You may contract a debilitating disease, or get tortured, or even martyred for your testimony. You may suffer rejection and slander because you stand for God's truth. Read Hebrews chapter 11 sometime. God's abundant life for some of them was that they subdued kingdoms, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens, received their dead, raised to life again. We may read that and say, amen, how inspiring. Well, let's just keep reading. Others were tortured, and others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, they were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. Make sure that you include all of that in your concept of your best abundant life, because it may entail all of that to be a believer in Jesus Christ. Somebody may be wondering, if I become a Christian and it doesn't promise me the good life and the solution to all my problems, well, then why do it? Well, fourthly, becoming a Christian does deal with your root problem, and it gives you meaning to life. It gives you purpose. Your root problem and my root problem is your selfish rebellion against God that alienates you from his presence. If that problem isn't dealt with very explicitly through the cross of Jesus Christ before you die, you'll spend eternity away from God's presence, suffering eternal punishment for your sin. Becoming a Christian through faith in Christ takes care of that most basic elementary need that all of us have. But it also continues to deal with your root problem, which is living to please self rather than living to love God and other people. Put yourself in the place of a slave in Ephesus. You're a new Christian, and you're suffering under a cruel, insensitive master who treats you like a work animal. Or maybe you're blessed to have a Christian master, and you assume that Paul is going to come along and he's going to tell him to treat you decently. But along comes this letter, and Paul confronts your attitude and your performance as a slave, and he doesn't say a single thing to slave owners. To all slaves, but especially to those with pagan masters, Paul says this, that they must, in verse 1 here, 1 Timothy 6:1, count their own masters worthy of all honor. That means reverence or respect. You remember, we've studied that in a previous study. Now, they may have wanted to argue and say, but Paul, don't you realize what abusive tyrants these guys are? They don't care about anybody except themselves. When I'm exhausted and I've already put in a long, long day and they have a need, they don't give any thought about me or my needs. They just say, do this, and I'm expected to jump to it and do it with a happy spirit. What about my needs, Paul? Paul says, your need is to honor these men. Why? That the name of God and his doctrine be not blasphemed. There's something higher than our happiness. There is something higher than our rights.
God's glory. Name of our God, being held in high esteem. This is one of the hardest realities to come to, but how we act, hear me, how we act towards an abusive person, how we act towards someone who mistreats us, bears witness to the God that we serve and the kind of selfless love that he calls us to model. We are really the only truth and the only Bible that most pagan people will ever read. Can they tell by your attitude, by your hard work on the job, by your refusal to retaliate when you're wrong, by your returning a blessing for a curse? Can they tell what it really means to be a follower of Jesus Christ by looking at your life? By honoring that authority figure, boss, parent, husband, governmental leader, by serving that person all the more because we are Christians, we honor God and we honor the teaching of his word. And if the authority is a Christian, then rather than slacking off and trying to take advantage of that, we owe even better service with proper respect, since they're believers. Paul says here, they are brethren, faithful, and beloved. I really like the comment that one man made about this passage of Scripture. He said this, owing to the false opinion of his own excellence, which every person entertains, there is no one who patiently endures that others should rule over him. They who cannot avoid the necessity do indeed reluctantly obey those who are above them, but inwardly they fret and rage because they think that they suffer wrong. The apostle cuts off by a single word all disputes of this kind by demanding that all who live under the yoke shall willingly submit to it. Listen, our sinful flesh is always quick to defend itself, to justify itself, to excuse itself, to exalt itself by blaming others. That is human nature. We're all quick to say, well, sure, I did wrong, but I was a victim. I was mistreated. What about the other guy and what he did to me? If he would just treat me decently, I'd treat him decently. You can't expect anybody to put up with what I had to put up with. That's what our flesh naturally says. But God does expect us who have been redeemed to confront our selfish attitudes so that we honor God and we have genuine charity towards others, even our enemies, by our actions and our attitudes towards them. Listen, it is especially when they wrong us that we have the greatest opportunity for testimony. Becoming a Christian means beginning a life of radical self-denial. Jesus described it as taking up your cross daily to follow him. Now, the cross was not a slight irritation that a person just had to learn to live with. It was a slow, torturous, methodical means of execution, of death. Because of the fall, we all come at life with a me first, I deserve fair treatment, I have my rights attitude. Because of the fall, we all come at life that way. One famous non-Christian philosopher observed that everyone loves himself most, but wants others to love him more than they love themselves. God confronts us by saying, no, love me first. Honor my name by your life. And love others and think of them more highly than you think of yourself, even if you're a slave and your owner isn't a nice person. And don't just do it with a self-pitying martyr complex. You must actually love those who mistreat you and show it by serving them all the more. That's tough stuff, isn't it? It's not easy to put into application. There's a fifth point. And we've naturally been led there, and that's that dealing with the root problem of self is a lifelong process. It's not a once-and-done deliverance
Wouldn't it be nice if you could just win the victory over self once and for all and just be done with it for the rest of your life? Never have to worry about battering yourself down again. That's not reality. That's why Paul leaves us with this statement: these things teach and exhort. They are present tense commands, implying an ongoing necessary process that has to be applied. This isn't a decision that you make once and it's settled forever. Salvation is dealing with selfishness, dealing with a me first, I have my rights mentality is not something that's settled forever. It's something that we all need to learn and practice every single day for the rest of our lives. We need constant teaching and exhortation to hang in there and to do what's right. The teaching is necessary to counter the false teaching that appeals to the flesh. And that false teaching tells us this: you have a right to be treated fairly. You don't have to take this. Assert yourself. That's what the world teaches. It's false teaching. Exhortation in this area is necessary because we all get weary and we're all tempted to take the easy way out of tough situations. Our Lord Jesus Christ taught that this is a lifelong process for those who follow him when he said this again: if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. To sum up Paul's instruction on how to be a good Christian victim: Christian victims must continually confront their selfish attitudes and replace them with an immovable desire to bring glory to God's name and express genuine love for others. As I conclude, I'll repeat this to everyone here, and I want you to always remember: if you are, ever have been, or will in the future find yourself in a position where you're sexually or physically assaulted, this scripture does not mean that you should silently endure that. A person who violates you in that way is not only breaking God's law, he's breaking the laws of our country that are designed to protect its citizens. That person needs to be confronted. That person needs to be punished for their crime. Neither does this scripture mean that we should never confront an abusive authority figure. But this scripture does confront our selfish, I've got my rights, I don't have to take any mistreatment, I'm a victim, so I'm not responsible type of attitudes. It confronts our disregard for God's honor above all else through the way that we conduct ourselves in our homes and in the world. It confronts our love for self over our love for others, including our enemies. It calls us, folks, to a radical following of the one who laid aside his rights in order to save us from the judgment of God. Romans chapter 12 and verse 21 puts it this way: be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the practical